mothers. Today I have a wonderful mother-daughter combination with us, and this doctor, she's been serving lot of mothers for more than 35 plus years, and she's a holistic pediatrician. Nowadays, for every small thing, at the drop of a hat, we have people giving out medicines, but this doctor over here has been helping mothers to help her kids with normal ways of getting better so that the immune system gets better. And not just that, she's part of a wonderful organization called as Heal a Child, through which they have helped scores of kids who could not afford any medication, and that is Dr. Kiran Krishnamurti for you.
Hello.
And we have a wonderful daughter, Aya. Aya has been a close friend.
Yes.
And she's a stylist, she's a fashion blogger, and not just that, she has styled the entire movie of Yavarek Subramanyam. And thank you so much for being with us today, Arya and Dr. Kiran.
Thank you.
It's
thank
such
you
a pleasure.
For having us.
it really feels so good to sit with the people that you know, and you know, to talk at a different level, you know, completely.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So welcome to Million Moms. Here at Million Moms, what we have been trying to do through our interviews is educate mothers in different aspects, because we don't have examples or role models right now in our society so that we can follow through. Before, in we had a big family setup where, you know, you can look at them and you can learn. But our generation, we don't have those examples. We're all nuclear family. We're trying to get everything out of life. At the same time, something is missing. So through our interviews, we are picking up role models who have set the path before us in their own way, and who have helped a lot of people on the way, so that you guys can come from a place of wisdom and talk about your journey, so that itself would become an example for a lot of mothers. So
thank you for considering me a role model. I think I feel humbled and also a little embarrassed, but thank you.
So Dr. Kiran, can you share your journey as a mother? How did your journey as a mother begin?
Well, my journey started 32 years ago, and it's still going on. Because frankly, it never ends. I mean, as you will agree with me. And yeah, I think it's been one of the most exciting journeys that I have ever embarked on, with its own host of ups and downs, which we have tided, you know, together beautifully as a family. And now when I look at my two children, my two beautiful human beings, I feel, well, the journey has really been worth it.
Worth it, yeah. You know, for a mother, the biggest satisfaction is the moment she looks at her kids and she sees them happy.
Happy.
I think that's what is the most happiest thing for
absolutely.
A mom.
Absolutely. Yeah. And ups and downs there will be. I mean, it's part of life. It's about how you navigate through it that really matters.
Nowadays, we come to believe that, you know, even with a small thing, even if something goes little off than what we have expected, we get really upset. You know, we don't know how to deal with the down. We think, you know, our whole life is screwed. You know, that's how our generation got used to, because we got used to, praise and, like, you know, all the good things are okay. And if something is not going wrong, then it's absolutely wrong. Like, we develop aversion towards certain things in life. So, in your journey, it's not just your journey as a mother. You have had a lot of moms. Being a pediatrician, I'm sure every small little child would have come to you. So, mothers have a lot of fears, right?
Right.
So, did you have any fear?
I think it's part and parcel of being a mother. I mean, even now I have fears. Mm-hmm. She would know that. If she's late, you know, half an hour later than whatever time she has told me she's coming, I'm worried. You know, is she in an Uber? Is she safe? Is she driving with? Mm. Who is she driving with? I think fear is inherently a part of, you sign up for it when you deliver your baby, when you have your baby. So fear is a very natural and normal thing, and it's part of the whole survival instinct. It's about how you deal with it that kind of helps you to, you know, tide over it.
Right. You know, there are two kinds of fear. One is you fear, and other is debilitating fear. You fear or you stress is something which will, you know, help you grow. You know, okay,
right.
You acknowledge that it is there, but you grow beyond it. You know, some people get so scared that if the kid is running, they stop the kid unconsciously from running. They say,
right.
You will fall down. You know, that's a debilitating kind of fear is what
yes.
I feel. So, What do you think for mothers, especially with newborn and toddler age group mothers, and obviously mothers with grown up kids also, it, like you said, it never ends. Do you want to say something about the kind of fear and how you have personally grown beyond your fear and let your child go ahead and do something good?
Honestly speaking, I don't think I ever had debilitating kind of fear. You know, maybe because I'm a medical professional, though sometimes that works adversely, because any small fever your child has, you think straight about viral encephalitis,
right?
You know, nothing less. Slight cough, you think of pneumonia. But other than that, I don't think I have succumbed to any kind of debilitating fear.
Mm.
Because I guess I'm trained to be very logical and scientific. So
right.
Somewhere that has helped me,
right?
You know,
yeah.
Not be a victim of debilitating fear.
So Arya, do you remember any situation from your childhood where your mom was fearful and she didn't let you do something?
I mean, there's never been a scenario like that where she's, you know, she got fearful or anything. But I mean, obviously, about basic things, you know, like, okay, come back on time, do this, do that. When I'm talking about like my teenage years to even like now. But in my younger days, I don't think there was anything where she'd stop me from doing or anything as such, because she was fearful, or, you know, if she was frightful about something to happen or something like that. She's always been super practical. Like, okay, if you run, you get hurt, fine, we'll medicate it and get done. She's always been that sort. So it's probably even, you know, helped us to even right now to, like, if something happens, we know that, okay, something's happened, now let's just find a solution and get done with it.
Awesome.
So it's always been, you know, that sort of a scenario. So I can't really give you like an example as to, you know, some frightful incident or where she's feared or something, but definitely protectiveness would be one sort of it for every mother. And I would say even more for, you know girl mothers here in India especially. So that's pretty much.
I'm happy you accept it, because otherwise when I'm constantly, you know, stalking her for her whereabouts.
No, now I give in. Now I'm like, okay, you want my friend's number? Please take it. You want someone's number here?
No, she's learnt it the hard way. Because if she wouldn't take her calls, before she knew it, five friends would have
were
got
already
the call
informing me.
And they asked, please call your mom, please. So now if her battery is running low, first thing she does is, mom, low battery. You can contact me on this
number.
Which I never do. I just need to know that, you know, where she is.
You know, that is a major difference. You know, we need to create safe containers.
Yeah.
Because the context has always to be set by a mother or the family. But we as kids, we think they are limiting our freedom, or why do they want to know about our whereabouts? But because you're mature enough now, now you understand the importance of, you know, like why that safe container is important, or, you know, that context of, okay, this is still, this is okay, but beyond that, it is not okay.
Like, where does that come from? You know, earlier I'd be like, why? Like, why does, you know, my parents want to know this and that and everything? But then now I know where it's deep rooted from and where it comes from.
Yeah.
And it's very valid, because even I do that to her sometimes and she's not replying. Like, where are you,
this
mom?
This is really strange, you know, if my phone is off. It's the same thing, roles are reversed.
Right.
So now I think that's
so
the
then I have to remind her, okay, listen, you know, I'm 62, it's okay if I'm out at 10 o'clock.
Yeah, but yeah, you're talking with maturity.
Yeah.
Imagine for some teenage kid who's just going through this, you know, there's so much trauma that they feel the parents are restricting.
Definitely.
No, I see that in my practice, you know, and then eventually it erodes into the relationship between mother and child.
Yes.
And it's very hard to explain to both, you know, and to get them. But I think naturally it changes and things fall into place.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, there are some mothers who are overprotective.
Right.
They want to know every person the daughter is talking to, every, you know, picture that she posts on,
or even boys for that matter,
social media.
Even sons for that matter, even they have protective moms, and they feel that their moms obviously are protective, not only because it's a girl child or anything as such.
Yeah, she's being gender neutral, which is the right way to be.
Yeah, because now safety runs both ways.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, absolutely.
Yeah. And also for kids, the kind of exposure that they're having with all the different elements, like we didn't have it as kids. We didn't have it when we were growing up. But now the generation is exposed to drugs and smoking and like so many other variations of it, which we are also not aware. So I think mothers need to be watchful. Because why I'm raising this point is now all of us want to be very friendly with kids. It's good to be friendly, but where do we draw the boundaries? You know,
that's no, that is a tightrope walk, and right. It always will be. It always will be, but I think it's really worth mastering. Okay, because eventually you do want to be a friend, because your child will open up to you only if you are a friend. Right?
Right.
But you need to still wield some amount of authority on the child so that child looks up to you as a role. Not necessarily a role model, but someone who can guide the child in the right direction.
Exactly.
No, it is difficult. But if you have to err on the side of being friends, is my advice.
Mm.
It's confusing. It'll always be confusing. But don't alienate your child, you know. Don't judge. Have an open mind. And accept that this is a different generation. In fact, my two daughters are about 6.5 years apart. And I find that there's a half generation difference.
Wow.
You know, even in the way they look at things.
Mm.
So I have had to reinvent myself as a parent to my second daughter.
I would feel it's like a full generation.
Full
difference.
Generation.
Not a half generation.
There you go.
Mm.
So these are the millennials. They think differently. Mm. They are exposed to different things. So I think we have to reinvent ourselves with times for their sakes,
right.
You know, and right. ours, of course.
Mm.
It's a win-win. Eventually, it has to be a win-win for both.
Both. Right. So another question is, when you gave birth to your first child, how did you feel in those early days versus Arya as an adopted child,
right?
Yeah. It's such a wonderful thing. Like even now, like for my second child, I wanted to adopt a girl. My parents didn't let me. My in-laws didn't let me to do it. Yeah. But in your generation.
Yeah.
How did you make it happen?
My mother never, always. We didn't ask, actually. My husband is a very, very strong person.
Mm.
And once we decided that we want to adopt, we kept talking to them about it. But somewhere, I think they didn't take us seriously. They thought these people just talk, they'll never do it. Finally, when we did bring Arya home, we literally called them the next day and said, like, guess what, your grandparents do.
Wow.
I mean, that's how Sudhakar is. He is extremely, when he wants to do something, he will just do it. And then work on settling whatever mess he has created in, you know, vis-a-vis the relationships with them.
So can you share your journey about what made you to take the decision?
Arya actually was always planned. My husband and I were in medical school together. We were 18 when we started dating.
Wow.
So somewhere in our early 20s is when he saw me with the little children in the general ward of the hospital where we were training. And one day he said, you know, he hadn't even proposed marriage to me then. But he said something like, you know, I think we should adopt a baby in life. I mean, the planet does not need more children. And what are we trying to prove? What is so great about our DNA that we need to replicate it? I said, yeah, why not? Of course, that was more than 15 years, you know, before we actually did it.
Mm.
So yeah, Arya was the planned baby. Ulrika just happened.
Like reverse.
It was, I think, one of the happiest days of all our lives. Sudhakar, Ulrika and me.
Awesome.
The day we brought her home.
And me too, obviously, because I got a family and I got such an amazing life. So
I think it's our culture and society which makes a woman feel inadequate if she is unable to bear a child. So somewhere that has to change, you know. When that changes, I think maybe more women will go in for adoption.
Right. You know, because I've seen mothers do so much damage to their body.
Yeah.
Because this IVF treatment after treatment.
What about the mind? The damage to the mind.
Mind, yeah.
It's, I mean, some of them go completely psychotic at the end of it.
And then you have a child after 9-10 years of struggle and they're so scared. Like, you know, like that child's every step.
It's very tragic. And I want to tell them, look, I've been there, done that. I've done both. And there's absolutely no difference, you know. So please, don't torture yourself. But no, it doesn't work. Though I have to say, more and more people are doing it now. You know,
there's one segment which is comfortably doing it.
Yeah.
But there's one segment, though
I'm talking about the urban, elite, educated, you know, people.
That's what you're thinking, Dr. Kiran. But you know, the educated ones are the ones who sometimes become very, very, you know, kya hoga, what's there? You just try once more. You have to have your own child.
I know.
I feel, where is all the education going?
Yeah. No, it's a very personal thing. So I don't want to pass any value judgment on it. But I wish society would,
support.
You know, help to view women like this a little differently. So mm-hmm. that they feel confident without having the need to, you know, get pregnant.
Mm. So, Arya, like mom said, there is a generation of gap between you and your sister.
Yeah.
But have you ever felt, if she was saying something to you, did you think, oh, she's telling this to me because I'm this? Or, you know, your sister, has your older daughter ever felt, oh, Arya is getting a better treatment?
Or every family. I felt that with my own sister
exactly.
and my brother. I was the oldest of three children. And I would keep telling my mom, you know, you like her better, or you like my brother better because he's a son.
True.
So yeah, these children have gone, both have equally done this, tortured me. And of course, Arya has tortured me more because she would use the
right.
ace on, you know, out of her sleeve, the adoption card.
But then I'd get that too, because everyone thought that, you know, she was pampering me, or whoever was pampering me much more because I'm adopted and because I'm the youngest in the family.
Right.
So again, the youngest girl child in the family, of course, you are bound to be pampered. Like,
I put an end to it with a very smart move. So once when she and I were driving back, and she had not done something or done something that I didn't approve of for the 50th time. So I was stern with her and probably yelling at her. And for the 100th time, she said, yeah, I know you're yelling at me because I'm adopted. Okay, I had heard that, I mean, not 100, maybe much more.
Mm.
I actually stopped the car and I said, you know what? You're really hurting me. And I think you're hurting me because I'm adopted. Oh my God, she just started crying. And no, you're not. I said, you know how it feels? After that, she never said it again.
She just reversed the role in general.
I know. So I made a very smart move.
But that's really a good way to deal with it.
No, after that, it never happened.
Yeah. I think all mothers, you should actually use this even for your kids.
Yeah.
Because, you know, dealing with kids itself is such a big thing. You know, they pull out right, left, center, all cards available to stack it against you and put it against
very
mothers.
True. Yes. And with every generation, the cards are getting, you know,
bigger,
piling up.
Yeah.
So they have.
Yeah, and it's like, again, so much stress on the mothers to deal with.
Very true.
Yeah, but that's a very smart thing to do, Dr. Kiran. Yeah.
Smart.
So, how did you feel when she said that?
I honestly don't really remember the scenario as such, but then I remember I was really bawling my eyes out and I was very sad and upset, and I was feeling like, why is she saying that she's not adopted? Why is she feeling like that? And then I said, okay, I think somewhere like later in the years, I said, okay, somewhere she's really outsmarted me in that way. For sure.
Yeah. So what if you would have to look back, you know, when you were with a small child, is there something with is there any advice that you would give to that mother coming from this age, you know, now that you have, there's a lot of
the advice would vary from age to age, but the general principles, you know, I think remain the same. Give them the freedom, okay, but draw boundaries so that they have the freedom to do what they want within the boundaries. Do not micromanage, okay? Allow them to develop their own thoughts and opinions. They needn't share the same opinions as you do. You know, at this point, I really like what Khalil Gibran had to say about children. Your children are not your children, but they are the sons and daughters of life's longing for itself.
Wow.
So basically, you're just a channel for them. Your thoughts need not be their thoughts. They need to have their own thoughts. So somewhere I think I, both, not just me, my husband and I have both tried to practice this, which now my older daughter tells me, and Arya also says that, how did you all manage, you know? Because I feel if I have a child, I'm going to try and correct her at every stage.
That's what we do.
Yeah.
We think.
So, yeah. So no, let them, even now when they ask me, you know, what should I do? I say, think, the answer will come to you. I'm tempted to say, if I was in your place, I would have, but I really hold myself back. Let them make the mistakes. We have to provide the safety net, you know, for them to kind of bounce into if needed.
Wonderfully said, Dr. Kiran. You know, that's what most of us are not able to do, you know.
No, it's not been easy for me either, but I think somewhere to keep doing it becomes a part of you.
To take a step back instead of just responding or reacting or trying to help them out.
Yeah.
You just step back and say, explore it.
Yeah.
Do it and see. Awesome. That's so beautiful.
I mean, both my kids didn't do medicine because they had the complete freedom to do whatever they wanted. Even when they were little, we would say, you want to become an oceanographer, do it. You want to be a gemologist, go for it, you know.
Awesome.
Yeah, the freedom has really opened us to whatever you want to do. And in that way, I feel Ulrika and I are extremely lucky to have parents like that who've supported all our visions as well. And because I don't think I didn't ever have it in me to do medicine at all. I genuinely get worried even if I go to a hospital and have to see blood in any form. So I always was the very creative one in school and college as well. Whereas Ulrika was always the studious one. She was all the head girl in every college and school. But my mom has never, you know, directed that or said that, you know, you do this because you're good at this. You do this because you're good at that. She just opened it for us and we've pretty much figured it with the support of them as well. Yeah.
That's such a wonderful thing to do, Dr. Kiran.
Yeah.
And how you keep working, even at 63, you go out, you work, you take care of Healer Child. Can you talk more about Healer Child? And
so my involvement in Healer Child is on the medical part. So honestly speaking, I don't have to go out there and work hard, unlike the other trustees who are part of the working committee, who really meet every now and then and brainstorm, you know, about events and other things to raise money. So I come in for the medical review, on the medical review board. But yeah, it's been wonderful. And I mean, every day we get cases which, you know, really heartbreaking. And one feels good that one is able to make a change in their lives. So that's when I said I don't have to. Time-wise, Healer Child doesn't take much of my time.
But what keeps you going, doctor?
Life, my breath. As long as there's life, I want to be productive and make the most.
So even with small kids, Ulrika, when she was born, did you take a career break? Did you start working at that time?
So yeah, I took a career break as such for about a month when I went to Mumbai to deliver. 2 months. Came back when she was 2 months old, and the very next day, I had a home clinic those days where one of the bedrooms was converted into a clinic, which was so convenient. So as such, there was no break
right
from work.
And from then till now, you're continuing to work.
Yes.
Any plans of retirement?
No, none. I keep telling people around me that I want to have the stethoscope around my neck when I breathe my last. But yeah, I have cut down my hours compared to what they were earlier. I still have a long bucket list of things I want to do, you know, including learning Spanish and some form of dance and music. So yeah, I'm going to find the time and do that.
Awesome. So what about fitness?
Yeah, I'm quite into it. So my husband and I try to go to KBR for walks at least 3 times a week. I've been doing yoga for a very long time now, maybe 10, 15, 20 years. So, and of late, last 1 year, 2 years, I think, I have a trainer who comes home 3 times a week.
Wow.
So yeah, I definitely spend a finite amount of time on fitness every day.
What do you have to tell other mothers who find it very difficult to find time to just run their life, you know? They won't be having any career as such, but even to just manage their day-to-day life with kids and all of it, it gets very challenging for some mothers, and they totally neglect their health.
Yeah.
What is your advice to them?
It's all about mind over matter, you know? And it's so important to be mentally fit in order to even embark on physical fitness. I think most such mothers that you are, prototype mothers that you are talking about, probably are not very happy people deep within. And the neglect starts from there. So I don't know. I would like to counsel people around them first, you know, saying nurture and cherish, and nurture your wife, nurture your mother, cherish her, and give back to her what she gives to you.
Wow.
Don't you think so? I mean,
100%.
It's very hard to tell a woman who's juggling, you know, sending children to school, packing husband's dabba, waiting for maids to come, giving, to say go and do yoga.
Exactly.
Pavana. There's no mental
space.
So people around have to create that environment. I think we owe it to the woman.
So Arya, what do you think, how important is fitness for a woman in general?
I feel fitness is extremely important, especially in today's day and age where it's more about you need to be physically fit to be mentally fit and to take care of yourself and to, you know, have a life and, you know, go about your life. So I feel like my mom also says, it's correlated, right? If you're not mentally, when you're not physically fit, you're not mentally fit as well. And then that's when you feel really lethargic and tired and stuff in general. So I feel it's very important, and I'm trying to cultivate it and try to make that a habit for me now. And I feel even if you do small amounts of it on a daily basis, at least you're gathering up to, you know, do like a lengthy workout or like something that you're comfortable with. But some, it needs to happen. Something or the other has to happen every single day.
Right.
Yeah.
So when your mom was busy with something,
correct,
did you ever take up certain chores so that she can get time for herself or she can just relax?
Genuinely speaking, I think my sister was more of that sort. She'd help my mom.
Arya was always there for me in spirit. Go mom, just do it.
I'd be like a cheerleader.
Yeah.
But then at the end of the day, I now do try to help her out with her time, and I do try to help her out with the house as well and with chores as well. And now that she also, you know, in her practice and career-wise also, she has a little more time to spare as well. So we try to sit down, do things together as well. But when I was younger, I was more of, you know, getting pampered and, you know, just indulging in all the love. But my sister was the one who was taking the charge and, you know, helping my mom with things. But now I think I've definitely, now we've divided it and we both try to help us as much as we can.
So what would you tell to teenage girls or a 10 to 11 year old kid who might be watching this interview? How do you think they should support their parents?
Honestly speaking, please just be non-problematic, without issues, and very settled, you know, I would say, because when you're a teenager, you're going through so many mood swings, you're going through so much going on in your life, so much change in general, and you're obviously going to put your parents through difficult times every single day, because I did for sure, like till a while. And I would say that just be best friends with your parents. Please talk to them. And because at the end of the day, they are the ones who know the best for you and will definitely guide you. And I have a lot of friends who are scared to talk to their parents about certain things and, you know, certain things in life, which I find kind of weird or absurd for me, because I've always been someone who goes and tells my mom and dad every single thing. But I would just say, please talk to your parents and be much more open. And especially in today's day and age, where teenagers in general are very pressurized and very stressed in life, it's very necessary to talk to your parents and probably get another perspective into life as well.
Right. So, Dr. Kiran, what did you do that Arya could easily come and talk to you? You know, because communication is everything. You know, the trust that a child has, the trust that if the child trusts the parents, first they will come and open up with the parent. But you know, that's who they tend to trust their peers more than anyone else, and they start taking parents as enemies, you know. They think the parents are doing everything against them. There's
That's
some.
because parents, I think what helped me was I was not judgmental. I think when you're judgmental, you just drop a huge curtain, a huge divide in the relationship.
Can you give an
When
example?
you know, like if your child comes and tells you, look, I'm attracted to this boy, for example, don't judge, just listen. Just listen. There's, I keep telling my children also this about the wisdom of silence. You don't have to give an opinion for everything, you know. Or if, let's say, scholastic performance or anything that the child does or doesn't do, don't immediately label it as not good enough. I think it's when you have too many rules and regulations, then they tend to go a little astray or at a tangent. That's when they start lying. So don't be disapproving of every single thing, you know, of little things. I mean, if there is a major issue, of course you have to be. But pick and choose your issues carefully so that you don't come across as someone who's never happy with the child.
That's a good one, right?
Yeah,
Yeah.
definitely.
Yeah.
Not being judged. I mean,
Not being
that's
judged.
a very important thing, especially for the child, because it can really, really hurt them. And, you know, basically, it can probably make a mark, you know, in them when they think that their parents are judging them, when they feel that they are the only people for them. And, you know, they're at the end of the day, it's your parents or no one else, you know. So obviously getting judged like that, and I have friends who come and tell me that themselves, that, you know, it's not comfortable enough to talk to, you know, my parents about this situation. So hence, you know, I normally talk to them, or like a peer group talks to them. But they've never seen that with me. It's more like, you know, like a best friend sort of a equation. So my friends come and talk to her about their problems as well. So it's pretty much
Yeah, I'm the
where, you know,
universal agony aunt,
yeah.
agony mom.
So it's like, so there are times when they're like, no, I've come to not talk to you, but to your mom. And I'm like, okay. So,
That's very important to play that
yeah.
role also, because we're not just parents for our own kids,
Right.
but I think we are parents for our community too.
Absolutely. And
And
that's why I take each consultation very seriously, because I feel I'm not just treating the cold and cough, but also the mother, giving my inputs, you know, by sheer age and experience. I definitely am in a position to kind of guide them.
Awesome, doctor. It's such
And
a
I find that part of my work extremely satisfying.
yeah
You know.
yeah because you know disease is not just some it's a physical it's not just a physical
Yeah.
manifestation. There's some underlying mental emotional
Absolutely.
thing which
Yes.
needs to be
Yes.
addressed, to be looked
Yeah.
into and to be heard more than anything else. You know, all of us are waiting to be heard. We are waiting for someone to just listen to us without any judgment, without any glasses or without anything. You know, you just want to be heard just like that.
Which is why I'm so happy you're doing this, because as you will agree, a mother is the pillar, whether we like it or not. I mean, I'm not at all gender biased, But a mother does end up becoming one of the bigger pillars of the house. So it's very important for her to be mentally and physically fit.
Right.
Okay, not that the father shouldn't, but it's just little more important for the mothers because so many people, you know, depend on her
True.
For so many things.
Yeah. Thank you so much for this wonderful, 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 wonderful
Thank
session.
You.
Thank you.
It's like, you know, I'm getting enlightened listening to your words. It's giving me a lot of insights even for me to take back home and practice with my sons. So thank you so much for your time, both of you.
Thank
You're
you. Thank you for having
Thank
us.
Thank you for having us.
The 21 Days Challenge. Log into www.millionmoms.in. For more details, contact 77024-9110.